classical music, it's the one thing that's never let me down. When life literally meant nothing to me, it was Beethoven, Bach, and Chopin who saved me. I'm James Rhodes, and as a kid, I used to put on a CD, close my eyes, and listen to the great pianists. I didn't dare believe that one day it would actually be me playing. But now it is. I think if there was one composer who I could bring back from the dead and have a cup of coffee and a cigarette with, it would have to be Beethoven. We do share certain similarities, like autobiographically. It's ridiculous hair for a start, but, you know, trauma during childhood, I guess alcoholism and addiction, isolation, suicide, all of that stuff. The thing with late Beethoven is that he's completely deaf. He's laughed at in the street because people think he looks like a tramp. But his late music is some of the most beautiful, hopeful, kind of eternal, immortal stuff ever written. The first time I heard Beethoven's 109, I was 12 or 13, and I mean, it just knocked me for six. I was absolutely floored by it. It was like it reached another part of me that hadn't been reached before. The part that wasn't just interested in kind of ego and flashy displays of virtuosity, but it was much more about, God, this sounds so pretentious, but, you know, soul and depth. You look at Beethoven's 109, the original manuscript, and suddenly you're back there in some stinky old room somewhere in Vienna with, you know, an empty bottle of wine and a quill pen and scribbling away at this stuff. And you can see that he sweated blood over every single note. Every marking was thought out. There were things slashed out, crossed out, ink blots everywhere. You know, it's like he was crazed. He was demented. He had to get this out of him. It's like, oh, God, just, yeah. And he's like writing, you know, literally ripping through the page, writing this shit down. I get goosebumps just thinking about it. I was the kind of kid who, I think people would have thought, would have ended up in the paper and the last line would have been, and then turned the gun on himself. You know, I mean, there was a lot of abuse going on. Somehow listening to this, it just did the job, rather like heroin. You know, it just puts you in a place where, you know, even breathing is a big deal. It's, oh, you know, wow, this is amazing. I guess if it was to be given a name, I would call it probably the Solitude Sonata. It kind of has a bit of a ring to it, the Solitude Sonata, because it is. He's all alone. Not, you know, not just literally, but, you know, in his head, he can't hear anything. I love, you know, the beginning, Barenboim, you know, the great, great pianist, conductor, writer, he says that this piece opens as if it's a kind of the train leaving the station. It's already started to move. And so it's almost like the music is already there before you even play a note. And we kind of join it along, like we're just jumping on the train as it's leaving the station. So it's kind of out there in the ether, if you want. All very lovely, and then this weird chord, and these. So we have this kind of immediate change in tempo, change in dynamics and harmonies, and going from, you know, loud to quiet within a couple of notes. You know, this kind of. It's so bizarre. This is almost like a flute singing. And then just when we think it can't get any weirder, it's like something out of a Hitchcock movie. I mean, it's just so weird. It's like the changes and the drama in it. And yet it's not, you know, it's not drama like Rachmaninoff drama. It's this incredibly concentrated, you know, in one bar, I'm gonna just rip your heart out and then pretend nothing ever happened and get back to... And it's so kind of schizophrenic, almost. And the whole sonata is like that. You know, we don't... He totally rips up the rule book with this sonata. The first movement is, I don't know what, it's like 4 minutes long. It's very, very short. There's no real structure to it. And then instead of this wonderful slow movement, which, you know, we always get in the middle of the set, that's what everyone was expecting, we get this kind of incredible, angry... It's all about feelings. It's nothing to do with God or the church or the state. It's all about kind of interiority. He looks deep within himself.
Thank you.
Music is music, you know, it all does it for me. In the past, I'm almost too embarrassed to say, but I mean, I loved Wham. When I was really young, I remember Bucks Fizz hitting number one. Loved them, loved Queen, still love Queen. I could listen to them all day. But whenever I do go into a music store, I always feel a little kind of, a little dirty, like I want to buy classical music, but it's not there next to Muse and REM and everyone else. It's, you know, glassed off down in the basement or stuck up in the attic behind some kind of big wooden door. And I long for the day, right at the front of the store, in kind of prime retail space, is, you know, the disc of the Beethoven symphonies. I guess in a way I'm a kind of raging addict. I like more. If something's good, I want more of it and more of it. And for me, there's a limit to how much I can get out of a 3.5 minute song. You know, if I put that next to 25-minute concerto, which drags you through every single emotion known to humankind. It's, you know, there's no contest. You know, I could live 10 lifetimes, work 8 hours a day, and maybe reach 5% of the piano repertoire. It's unbelievable. So it's an endless supply of my favorite drug. We have this last movement, which is, you know, Beethoven was just the king at theme and variation form. I mean, he takes this incredible theme. He makes it seem like the whole thing is kind of condensing, getting faster and faster until it just explodes in trills. So we have the, which is just normal. And then he doubles it. And then even more notes. Even more, until we end up with this. Until there's just explosion, and finally, it's like the rage, and just all the demons are coming out and just getting unleashed with these huge trills. Back where we started with this theme, after all that. And for me, this whole theme is just, it's just acceptance for him. Like, he knows he's got his demons, he knows he's fought them, and he's probably not gonna win. And then he just, you know, he makes peace with it, and he accepts it. And yeah. It leaves me speechless sometimes. I wish I had that. You know, he didn't have shrinks, he didn't have self-help groups. He's this lonely, tragic figure. And yet, you know, he writes such unimaginable beauty out of all of that, that, you know, takes your breath away.